during that first cabinet meeting, there were some observations that supposedly it was an awkward meeting because President Marcos was asking for updates from the economic team. And supposedly there was no presentation there during that meeting. So they ended up with President Marcos detailing what he wants from the economic cluster. What do you make of that first meeting, Dean Ko?
Actually, I think that's a natural tendency for members of the cabinet to first listen to the important key call of the executive, of the president. And so the hesitancy is not so much that they have no plan as cabinet secretaries, but it is more yielding to what the president himself sees as the way that is crucial, that what issues are crucial for the economy. Although I would say that President Marcos is not totally empty in terms of what the priority is. I've been hearing him said the food sufficiency is quite important. And the reason that he himself takes over the Department of Agriculture is precisely because he sees value and the key role of the department in terms of responding to food sufficiency. That's very crucial. But I think the members of the cabinet were still, trying to feel and listen what are clearly the priorities of the president. And I think that's just in order that you hear what the president says. And should you align and make the plans aligned with this and pitch in their own views regarding how this can be filled in. I think that's a courtesy of the cabinet members to the president. But I also heard most of them saying that the bureaucracy needs to be digitalized. In other words, it's a response to remedying the age-old problem of Philippine bureaucracy, which is slow, which is inefficient, which is waiting for the long haul before something else can be served or can be provided for to the public. And digital governance is very crucial here. And we hear them from already a number of the cabinet secretaries that the way to go is also to complement their way of planning and working through digitalization. Mm-hmm. But let us also remind the leadership that just like any other plan, digital governance provides an opportunity, but it has also its risks and its, the dangers like cyber attack, cyber insecurity, including misinformation and disinformation. So I think, again, how to do this is a balancing act. But I think it is clear that the at least for the economic cluster, with a good number of the poverty issues, and the secretary himself providing support to the industry, making the economy robust again for a lot of Filipinos. But we were suggesting to the DTI secretary, mind the bulk of the economic sector, which is the micro, small, medium enterprises, which is very large in our economy, but also to make this more manufacturing oriented rather than putting the same old stuff all over again, but doesn't add value to the economy. And it is in this way that if there is greater emphasis on industry manufacturing, we will need the economy to collaborate with our science and technology experts. So I think we have to level up to be able to catch up with the neighbors. Otherwise, we're somewhere in between, I hope not, between Southeast Asian countries in the region and Sri Lanka. And we don't want to go the way of Sri Lanka, for example, no? So we want to be challenged by the neighbors like Thailand, Malaysia, Singapore. And we need science, technology in the economy integrated into how we do business, how we grow the industry, how we provide jobs.
And Mike, I will be remiss in if I do not emphasize the importance of having an inclusive economy. Often what we forget are the workers, the farmers, the indigenous peoples, the women, poor women, the urban poor. And unfortunately, I do not see them again here in this administration. I mean, not
me, they're talking plenty of subsidies.
We call them neoliberal, diba? I mean, so parang, what is in store for them? OFWs, we have Toots Ople. So I feel like OFWs have a strong voice. No? But the poor, the basic sectors, that's what happened in Sri Lanka. Look at what's happening now in Sri Lanka. That can happen to us very quickly if people are hungry, if people lose their jobs. No, so I hope that the economic managers who are, you know, described, they're all our colleagues from UP, as neoliberal, I mean, believe in the private sector, believe in less government regulation. Although someone like Secretary Balisakan certainly knows poverty and inequality. But I think it's very important to have very clear social programs, no? So that the poor are not sacrificed like they were sacrificed during the pandemic. That they benefit from boom years, like in the Aquino years or the Ramos years. So otherwise, we're gonna pay the price for not being inclusive as an economy.
Do you think the... go ahead, Dinko.
Dean Tony, I heard you mentioned about the migrant Filipinos. Actually, they constitute a big contribution to the economy. But you know, at the end of the day, the migration work is focused on trying to pursue the regular, the fair process of sending migrants overseas. But at the end of the day, we do not expect that more and more Filipinos go outside because there are no jobs inside the country. I think the balancing act there is we abide by the international rules and procedures of fair, regular migration, that no migrants undergo very dangerous or irregular processes as a respect for their human rights as migrant labor. But we cannot continue to be sending out migrants, coming back home and then leaving again, precisely because of an economy that is not robust inside the country. So I think our migrant Filipinos have earned so much, have learned so much from outside. We can have them reintegrated by sharing the skills and bringing them here and really growing the local economy based on the skills that were learned from outside, based on growing our technology, our scientific manufacturing, and growing the industry at home. Because at the end of the day, the wealth inside the country is the real trigger. And this is where inclusivity of women, of indigenous people, of poor people who have lost jobs be considered in the creation of a more promising and a robust economy.
Dean Edna, I understand that you have to leave in a while, so I'll post this next question to you. Do you think that the subsidies that President Marcos is mentioning, for instance, providing subsidies to extending it to tricycle drivers, would that be enough instead of, you know, heeding the call to suspend imposition of excise and VAT on fuel?
Well, actually, the ayuda is a very temporary, it's a very... what do you call that? It's something that cannot be forever and ever relied upon as a measure to respond to our ailing local workers, no, or the poor workers. I think that the economic experts of the president should find a balance between providing assistance to the low-income groups and continue to support them, while on the other hand, considering and reconfiguring how taxation can go. It is not an either-or thing. We understand that in the public fund sector, we need the taxes because that's the lifeblood of government. But how do we strike a balance between fair taxation And at the same time, remember that the bulk of those which are taxed is also largely government employees, people who are in the industry. And therefore, but we have come down at a very difficult level after the pandemic. So I think that the excise tax issue and the ayuda, the support, are two things which have to be aligned, which have to be balanced and thought out carefully. And I pass on that responsibility to our economic experts, Mike. Mm-hmm.